Welcome to New Hampshire Outlook. I'm Richard Ager. Every year, as Thanksgiving and the holidays approach, it is a time to gather and share fond memories and the latest family news. Often it is the joy of first birthdays or graduations, but every family also faces a time when a loved one is approaching the end of life. And how that person and their family members come to terms with death can make all the difference. Guest host Allie McNair recently spoke with two physicians who were widely respected for their insight on how to die well. But first, this story about a New Hampshire family whose mother spent her last days in the comfort of hospice care. A week after our taping, she passed away with her children by her side.
You're feeling okay today?
Priscilla Gilbert has cancer and is prepared to die here. Lynn Randall would like to make her time at the community hospice house meaningful.
This process is a whole person experience and a whole family experience, and so it's not just medically driven. It's looking at all of what makes up this individual. That's why we have pet therapy, and we have music therapy, and we have art therapy. There are different things that resonate inside someone and inside family members, and so to have all of the team finding ways to connect with the family and the patient.
This is the end of the day.
This is how Priscilla's family is connecting with her.
Family is family, so you're, no matter what you're doing, you're still part of the family. But when you can let somebody else do some of that, you can spend time on a personal basis instead of on a, might say, a professional basis. And it's far less painful for the caregiver to have somebody who's professional and knows what they're doing than trying to figure it out and trying to deal with it on your own.
And I think there's a shift that happens towards the end of life. Focus moves away from quality of life to what's meaningful. People will say, this doesn't feel like quality anymore. I can't get up, I can't do, I can't sit and talk with my loved ones like I could before. But what's meaningful can still be addressed.
Thank you, Charlie.
We're going to talk today about dying well. What does that mean? Are we doing that here in the United States? And here to talk about that, joining me is Dr. Ira Byock. Ira is the Director of Palliative Medicine at Dartmouth-Hitchcock Medical Center and also the author of several books, including Dying Well. Thank you for coming in, Ira.
Pleasure.
Also with me is Dr. Elliott Fisher. Dr. Fisher is the Director of the Center for Population Health at the Dartmouth Medical School. Thank you to you, Elliott, for coming in.
Oh, it's great to be here.
Ira, what are we doing right now, or are we doing things right? I mean, people are not dying where they want to die.
It's true. I think we've made a great deal of progress. Hospice care has grown in this country. Something like 1.4 million Americans are touched by hospice care every year. Probably about 40% of American deaths occur with some degree of hospice care. Palliative care, what now I practice in this hospital, has grown nationally. Most of the hospitals, over 200 beds, have some degree of a palliative care program. The specialty is now fully recognized in American medicine, and we're training fellows and new specialists in palliative medicine. But at the same time, there's been countervailing changes, and frankly, disease treatment has become ever more potent, and people are receiving ever more aggressive treatments through the last months of life. So there has been countervailing forces, and although we have better knowledge and skills of how to care well for people through the end of life, let's face it, people don't want to die, and they don't want their loved ones to die. And our health system is really a disease treatment system that continues to offer more disease treatments to people. So what I've seen over the 30 years that I've been practicing is that actually people are living longer, but they're also actually sicker as they die. What I mean by that is they have accumulated more burden of disease because they have been using treatments to stay alive longer, which is a good thing, but none of that disease treatment or prolonged life has made us immortal. So we do at some point have to look at how we balance the two in this new unprecedented situation that our society is now living in.
Well, and you have to look at quality of life at some point, do you not? Because, I mean, there may be those treatments out there that can help me, but what is my quality of life like as my life is extended, but I'm sicker?
That's right. And I think that's the tension that all of us now are living through. Certainly Elliott and I as care providers and professionals, but also patients and their families having to live with that tension of, well, you know, more treatment may keep us alive, but at some point in time, because we are mortal, there will be diminishing returns on our investment in terms of the discomfort of treatments, but also where the treatments make us live. You know, it sometimes, as disease advances, more treatment ties you to hospitals and to clinics, and there's opportunity costs, if you will, where if you want to be at home and focusing on comfort, well, there is a tension. You, at some point, you can't have both.
Right. Speak to it, if you could, Elliott, about the numbers then. When you look at, say, Medicare providing, you know, funding for health care, majority of that money is going to end-of-life care, is it not?
No, a large fraction is going to treat people who are seriously ill. I mean, most Medicare spending is devoted to people with serious chronic illness. And probably 30% of Medicare spending is devoted to people in the last few months of life, last 6 months of life. But I think the key point for us to recognize is that there is plenty of money in American medicine, and it's not going to be about, we don't need to try to improve care for the dying in order to reduce costs. We can improve care to the dying, and a byproduct of that almost certainly will be reduced costs. Because as you know, as Ira was already saying, most patients would prefer to die at home. The question is, how can we help them recognize when it's time to stop? When, if they don't have much time left, where would they most like to spend that time?
As a physician, is that difficult? I mean, it's got to be for you as a physician to know when that time arrives, is it not?
Oh, it's very difficult. In some cases, it's clearer than in other cases. There certainly, and that's where the real opportunities lie. You know, for patients who are old and frail and have had multiple hospitalizations, the probability of being saved if you're sent back to the hospital, say with your heart stopping, gosh, the probability is almost zero. So you might want to let your caregivers, the nursing home or the emergency medicine providers, know that you wouldn't want your heart restarted, you know, if you reach that point. There are many places where we can really help. Help make sure that patients are getting the care they want and need and no more.
Okay, and the question then becomes, and you go through this, I'm sure both of you, competing thoughts on what someone does want or the conversation not even taking place until that critical moment.
I think what's really happening is that we're avoiding the conversation, which is to some extent understandable when you're a teenager or a young adult. But when you're somebody with a chronic disease, or you're somebody who is, you know, aging and frail, it's not a matter of if you're going to die, which is what most of us tend to say.
I said it to you before we started today, so.
But it really is a matter of when. And while not being, you know, morbid about it or depressing about it, we do have to at some point begin to look at how does this story end, so that it ends well from your perspective in your values. I don't know what that looks like. I often will ask people when I first see them, first I'll say, my goal is to give you the best care possible. And that means attending not only to your disease and helping you live longer, but also to how this illness is affecting your comfort and your quality of life, your feelings, your hopes, your fears, as well as how it's affecting your family. Tell me what that looks like to you. And I'll ask that question again from time to time. I've sort of built a vessel, if you will, of the best care possible. It's what we all want. It's what we all want to give our patients. I don't know what it is for you or you, but as we begin to build a relationship, you can help fill that empty vessel with the particulars of your own values and preferences. In doing that in a mature way, we have to acknowledge that at some point in time, we want to help you live longer and live well, but most people, the vast majority of people, eventually would like to die gently, in comfort, with their dignity respected, And most of us would like to die in a home or home-like environment surrounded by people we know and care for and who care about us.
So is the way our health care system set up now not allowing for that, obviously, to happen? What do we do?
Well, I think there are a couple of problems in the current health care system. You know, we have a health care system that is, as Ira was saying, completely focused on disease and on treatment. You know, many oncologists, most cancer specialists, feel almost obliged to deny the fact that these patients are going to die and to continue to offer medicines, even when those medicines offer almost no benefit, where they actually know in their heart that this medication is really not going to extend their life. And having a serious, we're not doing as good a job as we could as clinicians about making sure that we let our patients understand what's the chances of you really recovering from this particular episode.
Tell me about the situation with your mom.
Well, you know, so just 2 months ago, my mother died. And I knew she was going to die. She was frail. She'd been in and out of the hospital. But I wasn't sure exactly how she wanted to die. And my wife, bless her, a physician, a geriatrician, said, Elliott, you have to have a conversation with your mother while she's still on top of her game and can tell you and your brother what she really wants. She was very clear. Although she was in the hospital, she wanted to go home. But she didn't want to die in an intensive care unit. She didn't want to die in surgery. She didn't want to have her heart started again. She didn't want tubes. She was very clear. We talked about what the risks and benefits of those things were, the chances that they really wouldn't do much good for her, and what the experience would be like for her and for her husband to see this. So she was very clear. About 2 weeks after this conversation, I get a call in the middle of the night from the doctor who's taking care of her, and he says, she's very, very sick. She may not make it. What should we do? We could take her to the operating room. I said, I know she doesn't want that, because she'd been very clear. Well, we could give her antibiotics. And I said, well, that might give her a chance to get home. Let's give her the antibiotics. My brother and I got there within a few hours. She was near enough by. She was still alert. We were able to have a wonderful conversation. She was able to apologize for the things that she felt badly about, which surprised us. You know, we were able to apologize for being brats. And then we just had this wonderful 12 hours where she slipped away. And it was the most peaceful, you know, beautiful, healing experience for my brother and for me. And so, you know, I just come away from that, you know, how important that conversation was. And, you know, and so figuring out how to help people have those conversations in time while they can still have them.
And I bet you, Ira, would love to see your patients and their family members and friends have that kind of experience much more often than you do.
You bet. I think our goal is to give the best care possible. That means the best treatment for disease, helping people live well and live as long as is meaningfully valuable to them, but also to have them die well. Well, not just as a process of dying, but as Elliott's mother sounds like she was able to achieve, to have some sense of well-being even as one is dying. That's really what success looks like from my perspective as a doctor who cares a lot about patients. You know, people don't want their loved one to die. The worst thing, when somebody we love is ill, the worst thing we can imagine is having our mother or father or husband or wife die. But in fact, those of us who work in academic teaching hospitals and cutting-edge medical centers know that there are worse things than having someone you love die. Most profoundly, there's having someone you love die badly, suffering as they die, having things left unsaid that you would want to have said as somebody is dying. Those are things that we can fix. We can't make people immortal, but we can walk and chew gum at the same time. We can treat disease as long as that makes sense and is within the person's values and preferences, but we can also not abandon them to figure out this dying thing on their own as if they were the first people on the planet to do it. We can suggest things that may be of value to them. We can ask them, what would be left undone in your life? What would be left unsaid with the people you love or once loved? That's the sort of thing that we can help people through. Of course we can treat pain better than we have in the last few decades. In this environment, at Dartmouth-Hitchcock Medical Center, we're really getting very good at making sure people's comfort is assured, that their physical pain is assured. We're asking people about their preferences, who they'd want to have speak for them, you know, what they would want in terms of aggressive treatments, and helping them to craft what the last chapter of life looks
like.
So
this isn't in place in all locations where people go to die. I mean, that kind of protocol,
no.
Or making sure. I need to ask, so how do you get to the point of that conversation with a loved one or friend? How did you ever bring it up with your mom?
I said, Mom, we've got to talk. You know, we know you're sick. We know you've been in and out of the hospital. You are going to die at some point in the next months or year. And I really need to know, as your son, how I can help, what you really want from the healthcare system. You know, my day job as a healthcare researcher has shown that there are huge differences in how people die across the country. There are places where 60, 70%, 80% of the population is dying in the hospital, you know, tied up to tubes in intensive care units with everything being done. And while they may assume that they're doing what the patients wanted, I think we know that they've probably missed some opportunities to align care with what patients really value. There are other communities where almost no one is dying in an intensive care unit.
Due to lack of technology, though, right?
This is not a lack of technology.
Okay.
This is about, I mean, the places, you know, whether it's La Crosse, Wisconsin, where they've made a very systematic effort to have conversations in the community to make sure everybody fills out an advance directive.
Right.
And so that it's assumed that you've had a conversation with your family about what your values are. And the hospital cares deeply about making sure care is aligned with patients' preferences. Well, they have the lowest intensity of end-of-life treatment in the country. And it's not about saving money. It does happen to cost less there. But this is about aligning care with what patients and families
really want.
That's right. And putting the systems in place can help it.
Well, it concerns me somewhat when you say a lot of doctors don't know how to have that conversation either.
We're not teaching them. They didn't grow up knowing it. They don't teach it in high school or in college. If we don't teach it in medical school, and if we don't teach it in residency training, is it any wonder that physicians in practice still feel awkward talking to people about the fact that they're going to die?
There is a wonderful article in The New Yorker from this summer, August 2nd. Atul Gawande, a preeminent surgeon and writer, describes challenges in end-of-life care and talks about his own difficulty having these conversations as a way of helping physicians and all of us understand how hard it was. And part of, you know, my conversation with my mother was only 2 weeks after reading that article, you know, inspired to say, oh, golly, I better try to do this.
Well, I would think, too, you mentioned your wife's a geriatrician, that people with that kind of background would hopefully feel a little more comfortable with dealing with that.
And stronger of character.
That's a nice
not
thing
all
to
geriatricians
say. I'm sure
maybe, but my wife.
She'll appreciate it. So we need to educate physicians or people in medical school. We need to educate the public, have that conversation. What else?
Well, I think we need to acknowledge, and Elliott's research has shown this very clearly, that because we're immortal, because we will eventually all die, at some point in time, certainly in the progression of a chronic illness, more treatment does not equate to better care. At some point in time, more treatment is going to be excessive and not really, again, give us the return in value of the investment in time, discomfort, and where we are, you know, not home but in a hospital, that we hope for. So it's right now, all of us, the medical profession, I think, can lead this society, but there has to be a cultural maturation. We have to grow the rest of the way up as a society and acknowledge that we are mortal, and at some point in time, living as well as possible means living through the very end of life as well as possible. That means not only living well, but dying well.
I think we also have to recognize that our current payment system has some problems with it. We only reward healthcare systems for doing more stuff. You know, we pay doctors for visits and procedures. we don't actually pay them for long conversations with their patients about what they really value. We reward hospitals for investing in all of this technology, which sometimes offers benefit, but much of it is used
Justification?
No, it's used in situations where you could just as safely treat the patient as an outpatient. But the financial sort of impetus of the system is to put you in the hospital, because if those beds aren't full, the hospital's not making its margin.
It's even worse than that. Is even if I counsel somebody and I want to get paid for the hour or more that I'm spending with them through this very difficult time of life that they and their family are living through, difficult but normal time of life, in order to get paid for it, I have to give them an anxiety disorder on a diagnosis, or say that they have depression. Yeah, they don't have depression. They're just living through a very difficult time of life.
Wow.
There is so much. Wonderfully, the new reform legislation includes a number of innovations in payment and delivery systems that I'm pretty confident will help health systems, docs, hospitals, realign their work with what they really want to do, which is what Ira wants to do, which is spend the time with his patient and give them the best possible advice. But the current payment system is a barrier to doing that.
That's right.
You talk to anyone who's running a health system, and they will say, well, if I do the right thing, we're going to lose money. Isn't that a tragedy?
Yeah, that's...
It's really bizarre that we've come to that point. And I want you to know, there's no malintention really
that's
anywhere.
Right.
No, I don't get that sense.
Doctors
personally
love their patients. Mm-hmm. They want to give the best care to their patients. But patients don't want to be dead. And doctors don't want their patients to die. And we have this huge range of services and scientific advances and technology to bring to bear to keep people alive. But again, eventually life comes to an end. And if you want to affirm and celebrate life, you have to celebrate all of life. And that includes that last chapter we call dying.
Yeah. I think, though, I don't want to say heat of the moment, but in the emotion of the moment, if that conversation hasn't taken place, for a loved one to say, do whatever you can, keep them going, keep them with me, I don't want to lose them, that the instinctual thing would be to do everything and anything.
Of course. Of course.
So
but that's
it,
why the conversation is so important.
But a cultural awareness, I think, maybe letting people really start to think and talk about it more. As you say, in one location that you mentioned, those conversations have taken place and you see the statistics prove out. So
that's right.
When the conversation happens, the end of life is different. Even one conversation, research has shown one conversation with a person with advanced cancer at the beginning of treatment for their advanced cancer changes what happens many months later as they are facing the end of life. The conversation of a physician asking what is important to you when you contemplate the end of life changes months later how many people end up in an ICU, how many people on ventilators, how many people have CPR. Very few people wish to do that. Most people would like to be at home and die gently. But if we don't have the conversation up front, the chances are you're at much higher risk of ending up as you do not want to be.
Elliott, I know you wanted to talk about early palliative care.
Well, first of all, as we've all said, it's absolutely critical to have the conversation early and often with your family about what you really care about or with your family members about what they really care about. When you're in the hospital with a serious illness, patients should ask for palliative care consult because palliative care is about making you comfortable with a serious illness, managing your symptoms effectively. And the evidence is great, as Ira already said, that early discussions with someone who can facilitate those discussions can really help improve the rest of your life. So I would encourage early consultation with palliative care if you have the choice.
How many hospitals have a palliative care person even, or a physician?
It's growing.
It is.
The distribution of palliative care programs is growing, and most hospitals over 200 beds have a palliative care, something like 70% over 200 beds have a palliative care program. Many of those programs are small. Our program here is a larger program that is deliberately intending to lead the way and show what can be done. We walk with people, helping them go through arduous courses of life prolonging and curative treatments, but also having an alliance and helping them with comfort and quality of life and the adjustment to illness as it progresses. I agree entirely with Elliott. You know, we have to be able to do both of these things, embracing treatments and prolonging life, but also ensuring that people are treated well through the end of life and that their families are supported. I think what I think we need to do as a culture is have these conversations. If you love someone in your families, sit down and have the conversation. It's not morbid and it's not a wishing. You know, we almost have a superstition. If we talk about it, it's going to come true. You know, we're still mortal. So if you love someone, find out what they value and who they'd want to care for them and who they'd want to speak for them and write it down. That way, in my experience, things go better when eventually one or the other of you are forced to face the fact that time is short.
You got the final word. So thank you so much.
You're very welcome.
And thank you to you, Elliott, as well.
My pleasure.
Ira Byock, Elliott Fisher, thank you.
Wonderful to be here.
Thank you for watching. I'm Allie McNair.